Good morning and welcome to our summer act of worship. Let's begin by lighting our candle. Peace be with you. Thank you. The theme for our summer services this year is growing the love of Jesus in our community. And Kelly is now going to show how to do this in Makaton Sign Language, which is a speech-assisted language for children and adults with a limited amount of speech. Over to you, Kelly.
Growing the love of Jesus in our community.
Let's begin by making our confession. We start by breathing in slowly. And we breathe out any hatred. Fill us with love. We breathe out our quarrelsome nature. Fill us with peace. We breathe out meanness. Help us to celebrate goodness and to encourage others. We breathe out our indifference. Fill us with enthusiasm for you, Lord. We breathe out our selfishness. Help us to reach out to help others. We breathe out our greed. Help us to share. We breathe out our fear. Fill us with trust and confidence in you. And we breathe out. Now let's rest in God's presence for a moment. Lord, bring us back to the life you want us to live. Make us breathe again in the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we're going to have a song, and then a reading, and then a talk, some prayers, another song, and then I'll be back with you again.
Today's reading is from Philippians chapter 3, verses 1 to 14. It's an extract from a letter written by Paul to a church in Philippi. Further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ, and who put no confidence in the flesh, though I myself have reasons for such confidence. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his suffering, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold for that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do. Forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Well, hello everyone, and welcome to Equatorial Speldhurst. I'm recording this on what is supposed to be the hottest day on record. So if I keel over halfway through, you'll know the reason. Anyway, today's reading is taken from a letter written by Paul to a church in Philippi. It's a church that has Paul has a particular affection for. And despite the fact that at the time of writing, Paul is he's a prisoner in Rome, the letter itself is full of warmth and joy. For those of you who like statistics, that word joy is mentioned 16 times in the letter. And most people think that it's probably the most human and personal of all the letters in the Bible. However, there's a problem in this church, which was quite common at the time. There are a group of people, so-called Judaizers, who want to take over the church. They believe in Jesus, okay, but they thought of Christianity as some sort of spin-off from Judaism. And they taught that if you were a Gentile and wanted to become a Christian, that you must first become a Jew and observe all the Jewish laws. And that would include things like what you could eat and what you should wear and whether or not you were circumcised, those sorts of things. But Paul says, no way, the church is not some sort of exclusive club that's open to just a select few. The church is open to all comers, male or female, Jew or Gentile, whatever your background, whatever your gender. Even lawbreakers are welcome. And Paul uses his own life and experience to illustrate the point. In the earlier verses of the reading, Paul says that he was a prime example of what it was to be a good Jew. He describes himself in the reading as a Hebrew of Hebrews. He was a Pharisee who faultlessly followed all the rules and the regulations. And as a result, Paul was respected and admired amongst his fellow Jews. And Paul doesn't say all these things were bad. On the contrary, he seems quite proud of his Jewish background and roots. But what Paul does say is that compared to having faith in Jesus, all that stuff is rubbish, or garbage, to use his word. The bottom line is that doing the right thing, that is, being righteous in God's eyes, doesn't come through observing law and ticking boxes, but it comes through righteousness, through faith in Christ as your friend and as your saviour. There's a wonderful phrase in the gospel, your faith has made you whole. Your faith has made you whole. It's a phrase that's used repeatedly by Jesus as after he's performed a miracle of healing. And it reminds us that we don't have to get stressed about winning God's favour and have to rush around earning brownie points. For example, Jesus doesn't say, your good deeds have made you whole, or your generosity has made you whole, or that your hard work has made you whole. It's faith alone that makes you whole in God's eyes. When we think about faith in this way, at a personal level, we can sometimes feel a little bit inadequate. Do you sometimes feel your faith is a shadow of what it should be? Well, if so, you're in good company. There's a famous scene in Luke's Gospel when the disciples themselves suffer a crisis of confidence. And they plead with Jesus and they say, increase our faith. I think it's an incredible thought that even the disciples, after all they'd seen and heard, should beg to have their faith increased. But Jesus reassures them and he says, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. The mustard seed is the tiniest, the smallest of all seeds. In contrast, the mulberry tree can live for 600 years and has a massive root system. So I think with some humour, Jesus is saying, even the tiniest of faith can, even with the tiniest of faith, you can make great things happen, such as a mulberry tree leaping into the sea. Now, I wonder if, like you and me, you've ever thought of the disciples as heroic, larger-than-life characters, huge in faith, a group of guys strutting around the countryside, full of confidence, on spiritual cloud nine. So it comes as a bit of a shock when we hear of them pleading for Jesus to give them more faith. Could it be those first disciples were not so very different from you and me? Unsure of ourselves, unable to trust God fully, afraid to step forward and be the person that God wants us to be, afraid to step forward and do the job God wants us to do. And we do all have a job. Faith is not a consumer product. I've heard it expressed this way. It's better to have a small faith in a big God than it is to have a big faith in a small God. What small gods do we put our faith in today? Money, status, power. There are no shortages of small gods ready to ensnare us. So it's not the quality of our faith, but the object of our faith that makes the difference. A difference to our lives, a difference to our community, and a difference to the world we live in. There is a danger, though, that with all this focus on faith rather than action, that we come to think of Christianity as some sort of mystical Eastern religion. Contemplation does have an important place in a healthy Christian spiritual life. But having faith is a call to action. It's a motivational thing. Faith is a treasure that you feel compelled to share with your family, your friends, your colleagues, whoever. Faith in Jesus drives you to be more Christ-like in the way you lead all aspects of your life. In the final verses of the reading, verses 13 and 14, Paul uses the metaphor of running a race. He says that Christ has taken hold of him. Christ has consumed him and has called him heavenward. Paul says that he will forget what is behind, all that stuff about rules and regulations, and press on toward the goal and to win the prize. The imagery is of every muscle or sinew pressing, stretching, striving. And the goal is to be more Christ-like. And the prize is nothing less than a place in the kingdom of heaven for all those who seek to grow in faith.
In our prayers today, there is a simple song for you to listen to or sing as you bring your thoughts and requests to God. The words are, O Lord, hear my prayer. When I call, answer me. O Lord, hear my prayer. Come and listen to me. Close your eyes if you like, and feel God's presence with you. Or look at the suggestions for prayer on the next few slides as the music plays.
Oh Lord, hear my prayer. Oh Lord, hear my prayer. When I call, answer me. Oh Lord,
and now let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We see the hand of God in the light.
There are always a lot of thank yous for an online service. There's not only the people that you've seen on the screen, but there are others in the background beavering away to give a good presentation of today's act of worship. And so we thank them all. And now we have a closing prayer. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the source of all goodness and growth, pour his blessing upon us and all things created. May he help us as we seek to grow the love of Jesus in our community. May we use our giftings to his glory and the welfare of all peoples. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all, today, this week, and forevermore. Amen. Now let's blow out our candle, but before that we will say, go in peace. Go in joy. Go in love. And now all that's left is to say goodbye. Goodbye.
To thy great faithfulness, mercy.